My name is John Miller. I'm the Vice President of Global Policy and Law at ITI, where I lead our global cybersecurity and privacy policy work. I'd like to thank our hosts and conference organizers, Telecomp, as well as the sponsors, and thank everyone for attending today. As you can see, I'm not only going to speak about cybersecurity, I'm going to talk about privacy and also some of the other issues, because one of the things that we at ITI truly believe is that the biggest challenges facing the global ICT sector are in fact all interconnected, particularly privacy, cybersecurity, and data flows raise some of the biggest issues. And I do have a few slides, although we are unlikely to get to them all. Just a word about ITI before I begin, and actually I should have started by answering the question that I guess everyone wants to know, which is who's going to win the US election. I'm based in Washington, DC. I don't know, so I'll just get that out of the way right now. So ITI is the premier policy and advocacy organization for the world's leading innovation companies. We advocate for global policies that advance industry leadership, open access to new and emerging markets, promote e-commerce expansion, drive sustainability and efficiency, protect consumer choice, and enhance the worldwide competitiveness of our member companies. To let you see who these companies are, 60 of the most innovative ICT companies in the world, one-third headquartered outside of the United States. This is very important, and it really informs our work because we take a global approach at ITI and advocate the same policy approaches no matter what capital city we happen to be in, whether it's Washington, D.C., or Beijing, or Brussels, or Brasilia, where we'll be heading tomorrow. Taking a global approach is at once our top priority and challenge because policymakers don't necessarily look at these issues through the same lens as global companies. If you look at cybersecurity, for instance, many times countries view that through a sovereign lens of national security and their obligations to protect themselves and their citizens, and that's completely legitimate and worthwhile, of course. But unfortunately, building the equivalent of policy walls at the borders of countries doesn't really work in the digital world from either a business or technical perspective, and may ultimately have the unintended consequence of doing more harm than good. So if we look at some of the top global policy issues for our companies, and really for the global economy, core to our company's ability to innovate is security, cybersecurity, privacy and data protection, and the ability to move data. Protecting data in the digital age implicates privacy and security. You can't have one without the other, and you can't build trust without both. Our members, our companies, in large part, they are the companies that built Silicon Valley and the internet economy, from the hardware and software that enables the global digital infrastructure to function, to the IT and internet-based services that have helped and continue to expand economic and socioeconomic benefits for all. Trust is of course essential to that continued growth, investment, and the ability to innovate. So really trust is core to our business. Without trust, we're not going to have much of a business, to say the least. Trade, however, is also very important and very much interrelated with privacy and cybersecurity today, because truly, there is no trade in the modern global digital economy without the ability to move data across borders, whether we're transferring data, communicating data, storing data. And this is really true for all companies. I mean, Brazilian companies can't build businesses that can grow on a global scale or even do business globally without the ability to move data across borders securely, of course. But that ability of companies to do this is really crucial, and it's also crucial from an investment perspective. When you look at foreign companies thinking about investing in a country, if the country locks down all the data they need to move out of the country to do business, it makes for a very difficult situation. So the value of cross-border data flows to e-commerce and digital trade really cannot be overstated. I mean, there's lots of reports out there, McKinsey report, other reports about aggregate dollar values running into the hundreds of billions of dollars between global trading partners. We will leave that for another day. But it is important also to note that the impacts we are talking about involve much more than just the ICT sector. The tech sector is really a horizontal enabler of services trade across all sectors of the economy, really the global economy, but economies in all countries. I was at a development conference in Geneva recently where they were talking about the services miracle related to e-commerce in many developing nations. And it's happening precisely because of the horizontal nature of the ICT sector and the impact on other sectors. Up to 75% of the benefits of e-commerce impact other sectors of local economies beyond IT. The points that I've just been making, I think, are even more pronounced when we look at this slide and we factor in emerging technology trends such as IoT and other CPS, cyber physical systems, whether we're talking about smart cities, smart grid, artificial intelligence and big data analytics. All of these innovations rely on data and data transfers to operate. And this graphic, I think, provides an important reminder of the scope and scale of the cybersecurity and privacy challenges today and the centrality of data in today's environment. The Internet of Things and other cyber-physical systems, of course, hold incredible promise for Brazil and other nations. However, we also see increased threats to security, privacy, and e-commerce growth when we look at this slide. The explosive growth of data and devices also brings an increase in digital footprints that must be protected. And this is people's privacy in large measure, as well as new attack surfaces that are creating new vulnerabilities that put the vision of economic growth promised by what is truly an Internet of Everything, as you can see here, at risk. Another key aspect to consider in this environment is that it's not just large companies that we're talking about, but multinational corporations can be just as much at risk as small and medium-sized entities and businesses and entrepreneurs, whether or not you classify the small and medium-sized businesses in the same way. And in some ways, they even have bigger targets on their backs because they don't necessarily have the resources or utilize the mature security and privacy best practices that many global companies do. So in a world where we're all increasingly connected, the reality is that we're all increasingly at risk. But we can't treat everything and protect it all the same way we would protect a, for instance, nuclear power plant. If you define everything as critical, then essentially nothing becomes critical. So a couple of the, a few examples of these issues, which, again, we do not view in isolation, but rather as they collide together. So we're dealing with increasingly difficult issues that are at the heart of kind of the conflict between cross-border data flows, security, whether we're talking about cybersecurity, national security, data security, as well as privacy and data protection. One of the examples, and it's alluded to on the first point above, involves the Privacy Shield and Safe Harbor Agreement, which you may not be familiar with. But essentially, the most important thing to note about that is that very recently, because of the difficulty of balancing policies in the area of global data flows, privacy, and security, the world's largest trade relationship, the transatlantic trade relationship between the U.S. and the European Union, was very legitimately in serious jeopardy, and some would say still is going forward. So again, we'll get to that a little bit more in a moment. Government access concerns and encryption, this is something I know that this audience is familiar with, and we've been seeing these issues all over, whether we're talking about Apple, the Apple San Bernardino case in the US earlier this year, or various laws globally, whether we're talking about the EU, China, Vietnam, or other proposals. Government access requests, not just to data, but to technology itself, these proposals are actually very concerning, not just because they're, you know, potentially creating security weaknesses in products, if we're talking about providing technical assistance or access to source code, but again, they really may disproportionately impact small enterprises and entrepreneurs because of a simple resources equation. I mean, it's very difficult for a company with five engineers to take one of those engineers and task them with essentially breaking the security of their own product to help a government investigation. So it's a very difficult set of issues, but not something that we and not something that we take lightly. The proliferation of siloed technical standards, and I really should mention this for sure, is really perhaps one of the biggest kind of resulting issues that stems out of these issues involving security, privacy, and global data flows. Siloed technical standards is the words that we have up on the slide there. We're seeing increasingly calls for localized security requirements, certification and testing requirements, all of these types of requirements that are based on a country-by-country basis or even a sector-by-sector basis, if we look at the IoT slide, could really impede the seamless functioning of the internet and global digital economy and the future of the internet and global digital economy, which have been extended by cloud computing and are being extended further by IoT. Multiple country-specific standards are requiring that non-domestically sourced equipment undergo differing security requirements can essentially lead to a balkanization of sorts of the global digital infrastructure, threatening the continued interoperability and any innovative technologies that have fueled the internet's growth. And again, this is magnified in the Internet of Everything context. Other security-based policies, such as proposed requirements for domestic servers, can lead to what some call data protectionism. Again, the net result of which is going to be a slowing or diminishing of cross-border data flows, which is also going to have a negative impact on commerce, a negative impact on investment, a negative impact on the, again, realizing the benefits. ITI has taken a very close look at the potential negative impacts of forced localization and other protectionist measures globally in these areas of privacy and security. And again, the impacts are only greater when we look at extensible technologies such as IoT, the cloud, big data, and others. Because if we look at cloud computing technology, for instance, several years ago, we had many of the same calls that we're seeing now to regulate IoT security differently. They were all being made several years ago in the context of cloud computing as well. I would say thankfully we haven't seen a lot of country-specific cloud security types of bills or cloud privacy types of legislation. But that's a good thing because cloud computing technology and these other technologies really just make it possible for more businesses and citizens across the globe to access more services via the internet in a more cost-effective and efficient manner. And again, particularly leveraging the cloud to extend benefits to SMEs and others, including managed security services, is really something that our companies really can do. I wanted to talk a little bit about a couple of very specific examples. We don't have a lot of time left, so maybe I'll save some of that for Q&A, but just really quickly, I mentioned Safe Harbor, so I feel like I should talk a little bit more about this for those who haven't been tracking it. Essentially, the important thing to take away from this slide is that for 15 years, in order to comply with European law, cross-border data transfer mechanism called the Safe Harbor Framework existed that facilitated data flows from Europe to the United States in compliance with the privacy laws of Europe. And over 4,500 companies had certified to the Safe Harbor principles to legally transfer that data. The Court of Justice of the European Union basically found that agreement to be lacking. So what happened instead is that a privacy shield agreement was negotiated over a period of really, well, in earnest for about a year, but even before, they've been working on it for several years. And again, we don't have time to get into the details of the privacy shield agreement itself, and it is a good agreement, mind you. Don't make any mistake about it. It does provide even stronger protections than the safe harbor framework did. But I think the most important thing to take away is that despite the distinctiveness of the EU and US systems, you know, the regimes really do offer an essentially equivalent level of data protection, provided that companies do their part. But the real question is whether this type of approach is scalable in a global digital economy that is so dependent on data flows. So a contrasting approach is something that's been explored in the APEC cross-border privacy rules system, which is essentially a common benchmark to address regulatory fragmentation among economies and the growing realization of the need to protect personal information as it travels across borders. And essentially what it does is it provides a mechanism to move data safely between organizations at the organization level, which is an alternative to assessing the adequacy of other countries' laws, such as is required by European law, for instance. And the other great thing about it is that once all the economies sign up, you'll be talking about the ability to transfer data amongst a diverse region of 21 economies as a business. So really briefly, the benefits here for government, it's a tool to maintain the free flow of data, protect personal information as it travels across borders. There are trade, investment, and economic growth policy objectives that can be reached by this type of system. Foreign companies are simply going to be more willing to invest if they're more certain of their ability to move data. And it provides business certainty for domestic companies as well. From a regulator standpoint, regulators often don't have enough resources to do their jobs as it is. And what this process does is make sure others are doing work for them. Certification agents, third parties, and others are actually basically doing some of the work that regulators would normally be doing. And then from a business standpoint, it's important because it's the ability to transfer data. It's important because it provides a mechanism to communicate companies' commitments to privacy, and it provides for more certainty and establishes trust with external stakeholders. So overall assessment, we'll skip that. Just to say one couple of words about the framework for improving critical infrastructure cybersecurity, known as the cybersecurity framework. The really important takeaway here that I want to just impress upon you is that this is a non-regulatory approach to cybersecurity that has been developed through a public-private partnership in the United States between the business community and the National Institute of Standards and Technology and other government stakeholders. And it didn't create any new standards at all. It identified consensus best practices for cybersecurity, grounded in sound risk management processes, which many of you would know if you work in this area. They're not prescriptive. The best thing about the framework of all is that it provides a common language for organizations to evaluate their cybersecurity postures and identify and prioritize opportunities to improve it. And the framework is designed to be adaptable to organizations of different types and sizes, and it can be customized to an individual organization depending on its risk profile, resources, and needs. So I'm happy to share these slides with anyone who's interested. And I'll just put up this summary slide of kind of some of the key elements of innovation and investment-friendly approaches that we can extract from these different approaches. And I will stop there and allow time for maybe a couple of questions. Thank you very much.